Hi, my name is Jennifer Beaudry, and I'm a scientist at Dynamic Earth. One of the questions I most often get asked is, what's the difference between rocks and minerals? Well, I always like to go back to the kitchen for that one. One of the big things I like to cook are cakes. Who doesn't like to eat cake? One of the things we need to make a cake are ingredients. So here we have ingredients like sugar, we have some flour, milk, and of course, we got cocoa powder. Need to have that chocolate. Once you mix all of those in, put it in the oven, you end up with a fabulous cake at the end that we can eat. So it took all of these ingredients to make your cake. Now, much similar to this cake, we need to have ingredients to make up our rock. So here we have quartz, mica, and feldspar that mix together to make up this beautiful rock that is called a gneiss, spelled G-N-E-I-S-S. So it's a pretty nice. When we're talking about rocks and minerals, and we look at this rock is like our books, our storybooks. We just have to learn the language in order to understand what they're trying to tell us and figure out what type of mysteries are we going to unlock. Now, if you go back to when you first started school in kindergarten, you started reading your books by learning the ABCs, and then putting small words together, and then sentences, and you built up your knowledge. The same thing applies to geology. Before you can start reading your book, your rock, you need to understand how to read and identify your minerals. In order to do that, the first thing we're going to look at is color. This one here, nice and white. This one here, looking more green. Now, once we've established the color, we're going to move on to other tests. One of them is hardness. So hardness is measured on a scale from 1 to 10. 1 being nice and soft, 10 being really hard, like our beautiful diamonds. That scale is known as the Mohs hardness scale. Now, in order to determine the hardness of the minerals, we can use some everyday items. The most important one, your fingernail. So what you're going to do is you're going to take your mineral and start scratching it with your fingernail. See that dust? This dust indicates that this mineral is quite soft. If I try it with this mineral, it doesn't work so well. So we're going to move on to the penny. We try scratching it with the penny, still can't scratch it. So we're going to move on to the steel nail. Trying to scratch it with the steel nail still doesn't work. Now, if you do have a mineral and you're able to scratch it, stop there. That's going to be your hardness. But you're going to keep moving on until you can scratch the mineral. The last object you're going to use is your glass plate. This one's a little bit different, where you're going to take your mineral and bring it to your glass plate and scratch the glass plate. Now, if you're able to scratch that glass plate, it means that your mineral is harder than the glass. So it's harder than 6.5 on that Mohs hardness scale. If you're not able to scratch this glass, then your mineral lies between your steel nail, which is at 5.5, and your glass plate at 6.5 on the Mohs hardness scale. So now we've determined color and hardness. So we are going to move on to another test, which is known as streak. Now the streak is quite interesting. We've observed the color of the different minerals. In this case, we have a mineral that is more or less black, and we're going to rub it on a ceramic plate. One of the things we'll notice is this streak that's left behind, the mark that's left behind, is more of a reddish brown. This is really a good indicator of the mineral hematite. If I look at this one, more of a goldish coloration to it, we're going to rub this down, more of a black streak to it. This mineral is pyrite. Once we've established all of the different, and we looked at all of these different clues, we put them all together, and we're going to use some reference manuals, such as the National Audubon Society Rocks and Minerals book, to help us determine exactly what that mineral name is. Why are minerals and rocks so important to us? Well, they're important to us for our everyday lives. Putting on makeup. Makeup, we use mica. For salting our food, adding some spice to it. We're going to use halite. our electronics, our computers, our tablets, smartphones. We're going to use subrate ore, or components of the subrate ore, which is made up of chalcopyrite, which brings us our copper, and our pentlandite, which is bringing us our nickel. These are all really important to our everyday lives. So if it's not a product that we can grow, we're going to need to extract it from the mines. In order to do that, we need to make sure that our mines are socially and environmentally sound.